Hello and welcome to the Scripts and Scribes podcast, the 2020 year-end edition. Happy New Year to you. Thank you for listening. I hope you're all safe and healthy during these crazy times. Today we've got a great group chat with some of our favorite former guests, screenwriters, showrunners, lit reps, and we're going to chat about 2020, the year that was, the year that wasn't. And we've got a great group here so far, and we'll probably have more popping in as we go. We are joined right now, first by the legendary Trey Calloway, the busiest man in the industry, writer, producer, showrunner on dozens of series such as Station 19, ABB, Rush Hour, Revolution, Messengers, CSI New York. He's also a professor at my former alma mater, USC School of Cinematic Arts. Fight on, Trey. And the host of the best annual music podcast on the planet, Tradio. So be sure to check that out. Link will be below. We've got Abba Jamshidi, lit manager and producer at Industry Entertainment. We've got Rob Edwards. He is here. He was on our last one, but he's here again, so it's great to have you. Screenwriter on Disney's Princess and the Frog, Treasure Planet, and a ton of other film and TV series like Full House, Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, and Living Color, Different World, etc., etc., etc. Paul Guillot is here, writer, producer, showrunner on NCIS New Orleans, The Librarians, Leverage, and a screenwriter of Geostorm. And Alex Litvak, another Trojan, right? Screenwriter of Predators, The Secret Society of Second Born Royals, and The Three Musketeers. Alex, welcome. Thank you for coming, everybody.
Pleasure.
Good to be here.
Now, 2020. I don't want to make it too depressing, so we really... Why don't we just start it off with good news? What's one good thing that you've had happen so far in 2020? Maybe we'll start with Trey.
They may not see it this way, but I got all three of my kids home at the same time in a way that I did not anticipate happening. My oldest daughter Clementine was in her senior year at Bates College and about to graduate. She got that cut short and had to graduate in our backyard. And my oldest son Crockett had just started his freshman year at Northwestern, was none too thrilled about getting that interrupted. And our youngest Cosmo is in his junior year of high school down the hallway as we speak right now. So I know that none of them want this to be the case, but we all got to be together in a way that probably wouldn't have happened otherwise. And so that's been a definite silver lining.
Great. Ava?
Gosh, for me, I just feel really lucky and privileged, you know? I think this year has really highlighted, you know, so many positives, and I'm glad to have a family that believes in science, and I'm glad to have had, frankly, an amazing year standing in my living room and been able to get a lot of people working, and grateful that, you know, writers can work from anywhere during a pandemic. So it's been pretty terrific. And it's been nice to see how resourceful we can all be. And another positive I would say is just even amongst casual, like executive and producer acquaintances, let alone friends, I think we're just all a little bit more real. And I think we're all just being a little bit more true to how we feel and a little bit more candid. And I think that realness is something I've really appreciated in all of this. Mm-hmm.
Rob.
Yeah, I'll, yes, I will piggyback on that, what Ava said. Ava, by the way, one of the greatest, managers ever.
We've worked together before. Rob's one of the greatest.
Exactly. She's fantastic. So, kudos for having her on the thing. For me, I think, you know, the same kind of thing that oddly writers, most of the writers I talk to say, I've had zero change in lifestyle this year. You know, we all kind of work from home. It's actually a good thing to not have to drive 45 minutes across town for a meeting, sit there in the lobby with the stupid water and, you know, whatever, have these things. You can just kind of click on your computer and then be done with it when it's over. So that's actually a, you know, it's a blessing. It's huge. Also, it has been interesting because producers will just call directly and say, you know, hey, you know, what are you doing? You want to take a look at this thing, check your email box. And, you know, and right away, you know, it's cut out a lot of the middlemen. You're having these really great personal conversations with people. So with animation and with, you know, some of the other stuff I'm doing, I feel, you know, I'm absorbing the blessings. I am glad that I don't have to kind of, you know, go out and into the fray every day and you know, and deal with what I can't imagine other people are dealing with right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Alex?
Well, let's see. Looking at the silver lining for this shit show of a year, I managed to sell a script in the summertime. It was a spec script with Chet Stahelski attached to direct. And my writing partner and I are currently in negotiations to sell a TV show to Disney Plus. So thank you.
Good.
Thank you. And then also, just on a personal note, my wife, who is also an entrepreneur and businesswoman, not in the business, thank God, she managed to save her company from going under, and then it was able to find another investor that actually not only allowed for the company to survive, but is now thriving and hiring more people, which is unheard of in a pandemic.
Wow.
So I'm grateful for that. Kind of just echoing what everybody said, the blessing and the curse of what we do is it comes down to the butts in the chair, fingers in the keys. And it can be challenging to do that in times when the world around you is imploding, but it could also be cathartic and rewarding to do it when the world is around you is imploding and the only escape you have is into the page.
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah. Paul.
You're up. Probably for me, it's deeply personal stuff, but I'm sure a lot of other people are feeling it. To me, the best thing from this year is gratitude, sort of learning to appreciate what I already had instead of constantly focusing on what's next, what can I get, how can I obtain that, how can I get that job, how can I sell this, how can I write that. It just, you know, has made me really appreciate how beyond blessed I've been in my life and career, and really I've got a whole new perspective now due to, you know, that sort of face first plant to rock bottom.
Mm-hmm. And this year obviously has been, as Alex, I think it was Alex that put it, a complete shit show of a year, obviously with the pandemic and wildfires and natural disasters and social unrest and the absolute cluster that was the presidential election. And those nasty murder hornets, I don't know if they're still a thing, but that's just terrible. And I want them to go away. But obviously the one that's affected people the most and the longest is the pandemic. And while I don't want to delve into that whole sort of thing, the vaccine is on the way, which is a great sign. And hopefully things will start to normalize starting next year. And hopefully we can get through this rough patch that we're going through right now. But I want to ask all of you how, and I think Trey and Ava and Rob touched on it as well already, but how has it, COVID, the pandemic, affected you personally, but also professionally? And how do you see that carrying forward in 2021? Do you see things just going back to normal once the vaccine and we have herd immunity, that kind of thing? Or do you see this having sort of a fundamental change in the way the business sort of operates? I'll start with, since it's business, I'll start with Ava.
Gosh, it's been eye-opening a lot in many ways. So I'm particularly curious for our showrunners here to talk about, you know, in-person rooms versus Zoom rooms once, let's say, everybody's comfortable enough to breathe the same air and air conditioning, you know, for a day together, multiple days in a row. But, I think this has been a great opportunity for folks who don't live in Los Angeles, who are looking to have careers and have maybe a hard time coming out here. I think there's more appreciation for just what it means to be a writer who can deliver and who can be, you know, be able to communicate through these sort of screens. So my hope is that writers are appreciated a little bit more than they typically are, which doesn't feel like it's ever enough in my opinion. Because, you know, the challenge of a lot of this was you had a lot of material sort of coming in And then when are they going to come out of the pipeline? So you had this weird dynamic this year, and every buyer was sort of reacting differently, and every buyer was sort of playing things differently. You know, Disney, for example, their fiscal year starts again 1st of October. So they weren't doing much of anything, you know, earlier in the pandemic. But later on, when a lot of other people had already bought maybe more than they needed, we were hopeful that Disney could now all of a sudden open up. So it became much more like, rather than, oh, you have spec season, or you have broadcast season, or you have this stuff, everything just sort of, it became more case by case with each buyer. And that was an adjustment and interesting. And then I personally don't know that anything will start feeling kind of normal, or that we'll get to a, just given how many anti-vax types are out there as well too. Like I don't think anything is going to be normal before next summer at the earliest personally. So even for myself, I'm like, well, I've been crazy productive just at home. Do I need to go in the office every day of the week like I used to? Do I need to do some of that stuff? Do I even have some more flexibility with my lifestyle and everything else? So, you know, there's still a lot of that remains to be seen, but it's interesting to have these questions that I never thought I would this time last year.
Mm-hmm. And Ava sort of launched it to our showrunners. Trey, maybe I'll start with you. How is this going to affect writers' rooms going forward? You know, at least your writers' rooms.
Well, you know, look, I've been on an odyssey for the past year that has been, it's such a whirlwind in and of itself, but then even more so since the pandemic kicked in. But look, you know, writers' rooms are shifting and changing in all kinds of ways, many of which are long overdue and frankly welcomed, at least by me. But the you know, as we all start working for basically the same three or four major streaming companies, and as they merge and gobble each other up, you know, things are getting more and more international, right? So I had run a room that was a Chinese American co-production, and out of that, I wound up consulting for Imagine and spending a couple of months last summer in Beijing running a room of 13 Chinese writers, which was an incredible experience. Even though I don't speak Mandarin, you learn about 30 seconds into that process that we all speak the international language of storytelling. So that's incredible. But then out of that, I wound up going to Mexico City for Amazon and working on Argentinian, Colombian, Chilean, Mexican shows. And then from there to Japan, working to help launch 6 Japanese shows. And then from there to London to help launch 5 Egyptian shows. All of which was incredible, and that led all the way up to in February of this year, and in March of this year, I was in Munich helping Netflix launch a German show, and then it all ground to an abrupt halt, and I caught the quickest emergency flight back, and we have all had our wings clipped since. So all of that was extraordinary, and all of it points toward, you know, sort of a smaller world view and sort of a more international effort in which all of our, you know, all of these skills that we've built up over time, we are now much better equipped to sort of share with others and vice versa. And we all feed on each other's energy in that way, which is great. But now we're having to do it via screens. And although it's not as great for my personal selfish travel experiences, it is much easier to do those things now. And so I just started last week working with a group of Taiwanese writers, and I'm about to do the same thing with a group of Saudi writers. Now, it means that with the time differences, I got to maybe get up a little early to do what I do, but like, it's this makes it much easier, more difficult in a lot of ways, but much easier in the ways that I think are ultimately the most important.
And how do you see it? Do you see it making a fundamental change, meaning going forward, or do you think it's going to go back to the way it was?
Oh, we'll get back to some version of normal. It will never, that's the thing about normal, right? It's constantly reinventing itself. And so I'm a little leery of sort of trying to be too nostalgic about getting back to any notion of good old days, but because they're usually not that great to begin with. But I do think that we will eventually. I agree with Ava. I think maybe late summer of next year, we're sort of maybe can get back into some version of rooms, which is in, you know, look, we all thrive on each other's personal energy. I can't speak for the rest of you, but I'm just frankly starved for hugs. So bring it in virtually. Anyway, like that kind of energy you can never replace with this. And, you know, that kind of spontaneity and the things that the magic that happens in a writer's room, it you can duplicate it to a certain extent here in the Brady Bunch realm, but not entirely. And so I hope we get back there sooner or later. I think we will get back there sooner or later, but in the meantime, you know, this is it. And thank God for this, right? This is this has really saved a lot of people's sanity in many respects, as challenging as it can be to combat the Zoom gloom.
Right. And Paul, our other showrunner here, how's COVID affected you personally and professionally, and how do you see rooms going forward in 2021? And has there been a fundamental change in the future?
Yeah. As far as personally, you know, it's affected me as you know, I'm sure other people, many people, I've had people with, I haven't lost anyone, thank God. But I've had people get sick, and that's scary. And like, I just found out I'm my kids are in St. Louis and I'm in Arizona right now because my mother hasn't been doing well. So I came out here to help out with that. And then I just found out my son got it. So now he's quarantined, so I'm not going to be able to go home for Christmas and see my kids. So that's brutal personally. As far as I think 2020 is going to fundamentally change what we do in the TV writing world, I guess I shouldn't say fundamentally change, but there's going to be a change, I believe. I think you're going to see an abridged version. I feel like writers' rooms what Trey said is absolutely true. You have to have that energy. You have to have that spontaneity, that immediacy when somebody is sitting across and you and somebody says something and they riff on that and somebody else comes up with something. You can't really get that via Zoom. You know, there's a thing happening with Zoom where we're all here and we're all looking at each other, but our peripheral visions, you know, it may be full of dogs or cats or kids or outside noise or things that a writer's room doesn't have. I can see writer's rooms going to 3 days a week in the room and 2 days on Zoom, you know, that kind of thing. And then one thing that scares me a little bit is I feel like, you know, the studios, their bottom line is always money, no matter what. No matter what they say, no matter what they do, it's money. And I think one thing, even though there's more shows being produced now than ever before, there's more opportunities, I think 2020 has made a lot of studios realize, oh, we don't need 10, 12 writers in this room. We can actually do this show with four writers or five writers. Like, that's a big thing. And the people I talk to, I haven't worked in a room this year. I've only done a couple of pilot projects, but the people, my friends that I've talked to that have been Zooming, have just said that there's this just feeling that, oh, suddenly, wow, okay. You don't need as many as we thought we needed, which, you know, there's a small argument to be made that is a good thing, but I think generally just from a guild member standpoint and a everybody, you know, getting a piece of the pie standpoint, that's a little scary to me.
Mm-hmm. And before we jump to our screenwriters, I wanted to jump back to Ava. And what are you hearing from what Paul was just saying in terms of like shrinking of rooms? And is that the chatter going on behind the scenes?
It was happening before. Yeah. How many mini rooms were we hearing of? Yeah. You know, you had all these mini rooms where it's like, okay, you know, the showrunner and three writers wrote all the scripts for the series. Like, this was the practice at AMC of like, all right, we're now deciding if we're going to pick up the show or not. We're not. Now an entire series with all of its episodes gets shopped and it's only produced. And then maybe there's the next season of that and maybe there'll be more people. I think the pandemic has only further reinforced what was already happening before.
Right. And usually smaller rooms tend to be sort of more top heavy, the more experienced writers, obviously, because there's fewer of them. So how does that affect younger writers, newer writers coming up?
It's incredibly challenging. I'd be, you know, just to be candid, I'm very uninclined to find younger, you know, in their career, you know, writers, because it's just so hard. And just having had an experience, you know, with Trey staffing a show in a healthier time 5-6 years ago, I was going, how do any of my clients get hired at the lower level? We just got 200 writers at the lower level to read. How does anybody get hired? And by the way, they're all pretty good. There's only maybe a handful that are great and really write, but there's a lot of really talented people who are out there trying to, you know, make their breaks, and that was in a healthier time. So honestly, it's just, it's going to remain challenging, and you know, the bar has always been, it can't just be good, it has to be great. Mm-hmm. And maybe now we're even going from that border of great to exceptional.
Right.
And frankly, it's who somebody is, I think, is also going to be important. Like, sorry, just to add one more thing, as a rep, yeah, it's like really knowing your clients, knowing their backstory, knowing who they are, knowing what makes them tick, and being able to go, like I have a lower level writer who just got a meeting on a show that we're setting today. And it's because there are so many aspects of who he is that are right for this show, and we had the right sample that could be like, he applies in this way, this way, this way, this way, from these backstories. You just have to try to make it undeniable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And as a writer out there, a newer writer, younger writer coming in, start to formulate that. You need to have, like you said, that identity. You have to have that backstory ready to go. And we've just been joined by Ian Shore, screenwriter of the upcoming Mark Wahlberg, Antoine Fuqua sci-fi blockbuster, soon to be blockbuster, Infinite. Welcome from Hawaii. You still in Hawaii? You are still in Hawaii. You're going to be there.
I'm still in Hawaii.
Spring.
Yeah.
Lucky man.
That's not right.
I'm sorry. I but there's nothing I can do. I'm trapped. They shut down the airport.
So jealous. So jealous.
And how you doing, Trey?
Good, man.
By the way, guys, the last time I saw Trey, he was speaking to my class at USC in 2007. He came in to speak for entertainment industry seminar. That's actually the last time I got to see him in person.
Wow. Did I have hair then?
No, you did not.
Ian, the first question we asked everybody, and I'll jump back to you. One piece of good news or one good thing that happened to you, Ian, in 2020?
Let's see, a piece of good news. Well, my wife and I had a baby in January, and he's been awesome. And you know, we get to hunker down in this beautiful place until, you know, hopefully there's a vaccine, and, you know, been able to stay writing the whole time.
That's about as good as it gets, right?
Yeah. That's at this point, I'm as given that we're, you know, alive and working, I've been, you know, in a good place. I'm happy.
Mm-hmm. Now we talked to our showrunners about COVID and how it affected them personally and also professionally in the industry and how they see it going forward in 2021. Now I want to toss it to our screenwriters. And I want to start with Alex. Alex, can you tell us a little bit about how COVID has affected you personally? I know you talked a little bit about it originally, but, and then especially professionally, and how do you see it changing? How has COVID changed the way you work and how you think it may be going forward?
Well, first of all, come back to what you were asking earlier. Yeah. Will it go back to normal? I think the old saying by the great William Goldman, nobody knows anything, is especially true now, because we can all sort of look at our respective crystal balls and say late summer or early spring. These are just projections. This is optimism talking. I maybe it's the Russian Jew side of me, but I tend to be more pessimistic. If we can't agree on wearing masks, how can we agree on a vaccine? I do think we'll go back to some version of normal. Also very much like what Trey said, normal is continually being redefined, but what we perceive or we label as normal, I don't think that's coming back in quite some time. I don't believe that theater going will resume fully next year. I think we are at least a couple of years out. I hate to say this. Simply because it is A, the supply of vaccine that's needed and the number of fully vaccinated people that is required. And then thirdly, we don't know how many rounds this will require and so on and so forth. Now to come back to your question, how has it affected me personally? Writing is always a challenge, but it's always a struggle. And as I said, there are days where it's tremendously rewarding to escape into the page when you feel like the world around you is on fire. And there are days where you're like, oh my God, the last thing I want to do now is try to write it as I watch people around me suffer and lose their jobs and lose their loved ones. We unfortunately had a death in the family. We don't think it was COVID related. It was somebody who had heart problems, but very abruptly passed away last week. And just having a funeral at that time was tremendously challenging logistically and obviously, you know, being able to grieve at a time when it's hard to come together is pretty difficult. But again, look, creativity is, I don't think it's fueled by happiness. It's fueled largely by pain and discomfort. So I feel like it's a good time to tell stories. I really feel also what Alois said is so true. There's always been a high bar, but now that bar has just gotten higher. It cannot be good enough. It can be even great enough. It has to be undeniable. That word that she mentioned, which I've heard several times from reps, from colleagues, from producers, like there has to be an undeniable reason for somebody in the world where there are always so many reasons to say no, and now they've just multiplied given that their production concerns, which are still being figured out, their release concerns that are being currently figured out, the feature market, which was already kind of in a bit of an identity crisis, is now going through a bigger identity crisis, just as sort of half feature, half television writer, I think I'm going to start doing a lot more television simply because I don't know how many more features will be made in the traditional theatrical model. If it's all streamers, I have to question how many more big movies we're going to see if fundamentally it's not branded. So let's say Star Wars movie, you're going to somehow blast it out in the theaters and you're going to release it on Disney Plus. Same goes for Marvel, but beyond that, I think big movies may be very much on the decline, because if you're going to be releasing on HBO Max and Disney Plus, how many $200 million movies can you sustain? And that used to be the traditional bread and butter of every studio. But again, that may not change depending on how this unfolds. I feel like for the feature market, it was a narrow window. The window just got a lot narrower, which is, you know, again, these days, I think it's all, at least for me, continues to be about specs. I really feel that the writing assignment market has gone incredibly small. So if it's all about specs, what is the undeniable reason for the feature spec to exist, especially in the current marketplace? And I really believe now there has to be either a tremendous entertainment component to the story, like just truly, like it is, it's not just a good time, it's a great time. I can't put it down. I'm so entertained by it, given like which is needed given the kind of the emotional burnout that everybody's going through, or there's a tremendous relevance. It speaks to something really important going on in our world, and perhaps ideally both. So I feel like for me, there's always, with every story I tell, there had to be sort of why now, why the story lens. And I feel like the filters got smaller and smaller, at least for me, in terms of why now in times of these, why the story? And I feel like every future writer I've talked to has also sort of wrestled with that and saying, yeah, maybe it was good enough before COVID, but now I may need to be more rigorous in terms of how I assess my storytelling.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Rob, same question. How has COVID affected you personally and professionally? How do you see it going forward as a screenwriter?
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, I think, well, starting with Thanksgiving, right? That my younger son lives in Santa Monica. My older son is in New York. And my younger son called like the day before Thanksgiving and said, a friend of mine had COVID and I, you know, so I have a contact issue. I don't want to come over. And, which is, you know, heartbreaking. But of course on the other side of it, like when the thing first came around, I called my doctor and I said, hey, you know, what's the deal with this? And she says, oh my God, I'm so glad you called. You were the first person I thought of when this thing came up. And I was like, almost, no, don't say that. It's like, dude, your list of comorbidities is crazy. So, okay, good. So I'm locked in and I'm glad that my kids are, you know, are respecting that. We're now gearing up for, you know, we're 10 days away from Christmas. And so now everybody is kind of self-quarantining and hoping that they can, you know, my older son can get on a plane. My younger son can drive across town. So, you know, hoping that we can do that. And I guess we're going to test everybody the day that they get here and hope to have a good time. So there's that. It's interesting that you would ask about getting back to normal. And I'm hoping that it is Ava's model and that in June we're all like, woohoo, you know, whatever. 4th of July is like, you know, have a good time.
I think it's more like September, but we'll see.
Yeah, exactly. Because I think it's going to be more like, you know, more like Alex's Russian Jewish model. And I think, because I do think that we're just not, the whole rest of the world is just laughing and saying, like, you know, why the denying? Why the mask denying? You know, and you look at Taiwan and you look at New Zealand and there's like, boom, they're just they're running the streets. You know, China, there's traffic jams because they're back in order. We're not going to be there for a good long time. You know, writing rooms are an interesting dynamic to that because there's nothing greater than a writing room. Having worked on, you know, TV shows for a decade, you know, sitcoms, it's incredible. And some of the best things that happen are these just crazy mistakes where somebody next to you will whisper something and you go, oh dude, that's got, what do you got to pitch that? Like, no, it's not gonna work. No, I have the other half of that idea. Let's go, you know, and you just go flying and it's just a ton of fun. And you can also read everybody's faces. You know, you're like, dude, you can talk all day, but that's not going to sell, you know, let's move on. You know, that's golden. I did do a table a couple of weeks ago for DreamWorks, and it was interesting because we had a DreamWorks animation and we had writers from all over the place, which was a good thing. And everybody, you know, people who probably might not have been able to get to town for the actual table were able to participate. And that was, you know, that's a plus. So you do get that. Interesting too, because I think that Trey was talking about the scope, like the places you can go. I'm trying to catch up, but the places you can go, and it has been really incredible that way. Because I just finished a Korean animated film, and so that was mostly Zoom. So it was like, okay, great. You know, this is fun. There's a translator, and you just get going. I helped out on a Spanish animated film, so that was a blast. I just did an interview. I speak French, so I did an interview for the Marseille Web Fest, and that was kind of fun. You know, it was a trip that I wouldn't have been able to make any other way. But they just, you know, they wake you up in the morning and you go and you get to talk and you get, you know, people chime in and with their questions. So that was a blast. So that part of it, I think, is really positive. You know, moving forward, who knows what's going to happen? I think that I'm actually hoping that we retain a little bit of this because of the expediency of it, that it's kind of between a phone call and a private meeting, that phone calls are just not sufficient at all. And I hate driving across town in LA traffic and getting there. And I just want to, like, you know, throttle somebody. And there's the, you know, there's some guys going to give me notes and I got to kind of get my blood pressure down as we're talking. So this is wonderful. I can have my little cup of coffee and, you know, and go. So I'm hoping that some part of that stays, but yeah, no, the magic of the room is just like, it's undeniable. And so hopefully we will get back to that. And hopefully this will be the last pandemic, right? <You know? laughs> This is it. There are nobody else is eating any bats. Just, you know, just leave the bats alone and we'll be happy. And we will all live our lives.
On that note, Ian, so how has COVID, which will hopefully be the last pandemic, right, that we face in our lifetimes, hopefully, how has COVID affected you and personally, professionally, and how do you see it affecting things in 2021?
I mean, you know, the first big thing I can think of is I came into 2020 really excited about seeing like my movie. Like we were supposed to come out back in August. Like at the end of the summer, this will be under control by then, right? So you know, the past year has been like a really sobering experience for me because they pushed our date to Memorial Day weekend 2021. Don't quote me on this, but they're probably going to move it again, just because Fast and Furious moved to that date. So, to be honest, I feel like when around the time that audiences are going to have full confidence to be back in a packed movie theater, I wouldn't be surprised if we're talking 2022. Maybe I'm overcorrecting from my initial overabundance of optimism. But that's what my gut is telling me. I'm not saying that 2021 is going to be completely dead theatrically, but I wouldn't be surprised if it's not fully back to life until the following year. outside of that, for a guy who writes at home, my office at home is the dining room table, and generally my average work day doesn't involve me going a lot of places or seeing a lot of people. Things didn't change for me in a gigantic way when COVID happened. It's like, oh, well, looks like I'm just going to be more of a hobbit than I already am. Like, this is, it wasn't a radical change from my day-to-day life, except the lack of options and the, knowing what was happening out in the world, actually made me not want to write for a while. I was early on in the pandemic, I was like, writing always felt like a chore, but if I was, helping, some friends who were, going through tough times, helping them with something they needed help with, or, working on a piece of music, or, doing some kind of charity work, that's where my real energy was. Like, I think early on in the pandemic, I was like, all right, nobody needs screenplays during a pandemic. Like, people need mitzvahs. But as time has gone on, I've gotten more back into the swing of writing. And I think the headline for me here is that pretty much since the day I started working as a writer, in some form or another, the sky has been falling. Like I sold my first script out of college back in 2007. And it was, I basically went to work right into the writer's strike and then the 2008 financial collapse. So like, I had everybody in my ear telling me like, okay, there's no worse time to be a writer right now. Like, studios aren't buying specs. Nobody has any money. Everybody's losing their portfolios. the whole industry is hurting because of the writer's strike. Like, oh man, did you pick a bad time to get started? And then in the years after that, because I'm mainly a spec guy, I kept hearing like, it's spec market's dead. Like the studios only want pre-branded IP. Like, unless you've got the rights to G.I. Joe, nobody gives a shit. So, once again, more of that sky is falling mentality. And with COVID, it's more of the same song. It's the studios aren't spending money. The theatrical experience is dying. Specs are dying. And some of that is true to a certain extent. Like I definitely am seeing, you know, like the spending freezes happening at the studios over the past year. And I've seen how the target you have to hit as a feature guy is getting so much smaller. But I think that, you know, writers at their core are resilient creatures. You kind of have to be to survive in this business, and that whatever the long-term effects of COVID are, the writers are going to adapt to them. Mm-hmm.
I definitely want to get into the whole Warner Brothers announcement of releasing in theaters and streaming at the same time. But before we do, we've been joined by Brendan Hay, writer-producer on Star Wars Detours, Harvey Girls Forever, The Simpsons, Dawn of the Croods, Gremlins, Secrets of the Mogwai, The Daily Show, and Robot Chicken. Welcome, Brendan.
Hey, thanks for having me on. Sorry for being late joining all you guys.
All good, all good. I love your sweater, by the way.
Oh, yeah. I'm very big on branding, and yeah, I probably should take this off before I share any opinions on Warner Brothers, but otherwise.
He's wearing a Gremlins holiday sweater.
Thank
yeah.
you. Thank you.
So a couple questions. The first being, what's one good thing that happened to you in 2020 during this train wreck of a year? What's one good thing that happened to you, or one good takeaway from 2020 that you've had so far?
Really appreciating being in animation. Since we transitioned to all working remotely so quickly. I've already thankfully loved working in animation, but the past few months, or yeah, going on a year now, I guess, has been like, man, we were able to adapt so quickly. So that's been really nice. And also just, yeah, it's funny just listening to what Ian was saying. I totally understand the having trouble getting focused for work, but ultimately, like, for me, work became like my source of joy this year, because it was the one thing I had any sense of control over. Mm-hmm. And it was fun. Mm-hmm. So yeah.
And it's a great segue to animation. You work in animation a lot. How do you see the animation business going forward into 2021 as COVID hopefully becomes less and less of a thing, less of a threat? How do you see it affecting animation?
I think it's going to be interesting. It seems like this year is nice to see animation, a lot more people wanting to try animation this year, in terms, especially like the studio level of people kind of finally seeing like it doesn't have to be just this one genre, just for this one age group, just for this demographic. Like people finally being like, yeah, let's try different projects in the animated space and see how it works. So I hope that continues, and I hope it doesn't become the, hey, we got everything else back up and running, let's just squash those and go back to how things were. Hopefully there'll be some actual traction.
Mm-hmm. So going to the big Warner Brothers announcement in theaters and streaming, yeah, I just want comments. What are your guys' thoughts on it? And, you know, where is this leading us, both in film and television? Ava, you are our resident industry. Yeah.
As a non-writer of this group. I mean, to me, it's first and foremost the sign of no confidence that people are going to feel good about going into a movie theater. I don't think it's going to happen. I personally don't think I will feel comfortable being shoulder to shoulder with a bunch of folks with no masks before some point, and maybe it's late 2022. I don't know. It just depends on, you know, how much the vaccine has permeated and how people are treating, and hopefully a little bit more kindness and empathy in this world starting January 20th in that afternoon. I think the idea that theatrical is just going to go away is pretty silly. As long as these corporations have a chance to make billions of dollars one movie at a time and then capitalize on more money when it goes to streaming, they're not going to leave money off the table. I think it's strictly a reaction to just the state of our world right now. So it, I think, you know, we've all relied on Netflix, both in our movie watching, but for me in a lot of my selling, you know, that's, Netflix has been one of the only healthy buyers consistently this entire year. And from IP to film and animation, I have a client with a greenlit movie in animation, didn't miss a beat as a director and co-writer. So like all of that stuff, we're still getting our movies made. It's just, I think our way of thinking of what success means when it comes to film is evolving. And if the goal is to try to get as many people watching your movie, then not much is going to really change. I think what we have to make sense on my side of things is making sure the deals make sense, because that to me is the biggest issue with what Warner Brothers has done. I think they really mismanaged it from a PR standpoint for not only your filmmakers, but their key people involved who all have back end positions. Finding out on Twitter, your executives primarily, from what I heard, found out on Twitter. This just shows you how it's an AT&T decision and it wasn't a Warner Brothers decision. Mm. You know, just how corporate all of this is getting. So I think we need to remember the humanity of all this, that these are working, you know, artists and craftsmen who have put a lot of time, love, and energy into this. And you know, you can pivot in this sort of way, but you got to have the human part of it too. It can't just be a bottom line item here, read about it in a tweet kind of thing. So, you know, I hope that there's a bit more thoughtfulness in all of that, but I just even talking to some, you know, name partner attorneys who I share clients with over the last week, finishing up some deal stuff on other clients we share. It's a lot of work for them right now, trying to get into all of this back end. And you know, it's going to be interesting. I mean, Disney, for example, has a delineation, and they did. I had a client's movie that almost got greenlit about a year and a half ago, and the delineation was, you know, if it's $70 million or below, it's going to be for Disney Plus. Above $70 million, which makes sense. These are all giant, big movies anyway that are in theaters for the most part. It's theatrical. So, you know, of course, first thoughts were like, well, what does this mean for my client's box office bonuses and the back end and all of this other stuff? We didn't end up having to go down that road, unfortunately, because I'd rather have a movie made than still sitting over at Disney one way or the other. And I'd rather have the chance to figure that out. But I think things will eventually find its rules for these other streamers as well when they're with buyers that also have theatrical opportunities. But I see this as a one-year thing and maybe a little longer, but I think what we'll see is a narrowing of the theatrical window is what I do expect that we'll see. You know, would in 2-3 years from time, would Wonder Woman come out for a month in theaters and then after that month, you could also see it on HBO Max? So you maybe saw it 2 times in the theater and then 10 more times on HBO Max, and you're getting people's money in more than one way. Mm-hmm. So I can see that being like that sort of quote unquote home video window. I think that's what's going to really change.
Mm-hmm. And while the box office has been top heavy for a little while now, how does that affect newer writers in terms of, does it make the writer who really only wants to do mid-level films more or less appealing, knowing it's probably in the future they may not get as many opportunities for theatrical release and it may be a streamer, or should writers continue doing what they're doing? Don't worry about the business, it'll figure itself out.
The hardest part is just getting anything let alone made, but even sold these days. So sure. Success breeds more success. And if you major in film, you need a minor in TV. If you major in TV, you still need a minor in film. And animation is a subset of both. So I think the goal is just to sell something. Like I have a client who's, you know, not necessarily young in their career, but it's had some missteps, and somebody who I was a friend with who I've been now representing for 2 years or so. And we've been packaging what I think is probably his best script yet, a super fun action film that was part of his love letter to Die Hard and John Wick. So just had a real, you know, pure joy about it. We've been packaging it since May, because me showing it to the marketplace does nothing for him, because we're like, oh, it's cool, but it's an original, or, oh, everything that's selling has like either IP or some massive packaging along with it. It's like, of course, Simon Kinberg's able to sell something, but like, right. My guy, we got to put a little elbow grease in it. Now we have a meaningful director. We have great producers. I made the producers compete in terms of how they could package. And when they brought an element, we then committed to a producer and some meaningful director, and hopefully, you know, we're out to some meaningful actors right now. And I'd rather take the time, and this was obviously discussed with him, is like being strategic, because getting that sale, even if it doesn't get made, is going to change things for him. So there's patience and strategy, and each one is going to be different, and each scenario is going to be different. But getting that win on the board, getting that announcement and deadline, that's what breeds other opportunities.
Mm-hmm. Jumping back to the Warner Brothers announcement, Trey, your thoughts?
Oh man, that's all above my pay grade. I mean, look, one thing that really struck me that Avi said is that I have so many executive friends who felt completely blindsided by that, the way the whole thing went down. And it was a quick reminder that, like, we are a sensitive group of people in this business. It's why we're here, and it's not limited to the artists. It absolutely applies to all the execs as well. And so I was really struck by that. I shouldn't be, because Alex, I think, was 100% correct earlier when he was reminding us all that it's a business. But I thought that was kind of shameful the way that all went down. Typically corporate, but still kind of shameful, especially in a creative community as small as ours. You know, another thing though that Avi was touching on that I would piggyback on as well, you know, having just finished my 15th year of teaching at SC, like now more than ever, I try and remind students that the minute they erroneously try to convince themselves at this point in 2020 that they are either exclusively a feature writer or a television writer, I say to them, is the same moment someone is going to step over their rotting carcass on their way up the red carpet, because it's all about diversify, diversify, diversify right now. And it's also about, like, you know, no matter what your idea, no matter what your great feature idea may be, or that you may have convinced yourself it is, now more than ever, you have increased opportunities for it to just as easily be a limited series or a long running series for all you know. So you have to really, really, really keep your opportunities open and diversify in that respect. I think that was it, except for one other thing, which was an interesting to sort of get back to when we're all going to feel comfortable in theaters. You know, I know Mr. Shore and I are kindred spirits in our love for music. But I heard a group of economists on NPR the other day after UCLA released this sort of prognostication predictive report about when the economy is going to bounce back, if the economy is going to bounce back. And they were all sort of knee deep in all kinds of, economic theory. But one of them finally cut to the chase and was like, I'll tell you when things are going to be normal. I can tell you in one word, it's Coachella. And the others sort of laughed a little bit. And he said, no, here's what I mean. Coachella was supposed to happen and Coachella is interesting because it has sort of it can have a fluid schedule. Really, all they need are the polo grounds. But, you know, of course, it was supposed to happen in April. And of course, it was canceled. And then they said for a while, we're going to do it in October. It'll be a fall Coachella. And then, of course, that got canceled. And then, you know, there's still talk about a possible spring April, but everyone agrees it's not going to happen in April. But this economist was saying, if it happens in October of 2021, then all of the positive optimism in the UCLA report about a potential bounce back in the economy, I feel, is possible. If it doesn't happen in October, and now it's pushed again till April of 2022, then I think there's going to be increased economic impact that we're going to feel. But Coachella, as an indicator of people's comfort and willingness to be in a big outdoor festival, means they're also going to Dodger games, they're going to Rams games, they're going back into movie theaters, they're going to see Broadway shows. All of those things give us that promise or that hope. And yeah, so I, you know, as somebody who's been to Coachella more times than I can count, like I too am looking at Coachella as that indicator. When it happens, maybe then I'll feel better about going to see the next Marvel movie.
So we're all on Coachella Watch 2021. And unfortunately, things like the Country Music Awards seem to have no problem attracting people. And they go on just fine in these days, which is kind of frightening. But
yeah, unless you're Charlie Pride.
Right.
God bless.
Right. So the Warner Brothers announcement. Alex, what are your thoughts, sir? I think you're muted. Let's see if we can unmute you.
Oh. Here we go.
There we go.
Okay. I think everybody's kind of touched upon that. It shows lack of confidence that people will start going back to theaters in 2021, which I talked about that I totally agree with. That said, the way in which it was handled in the business that is driven by relationships with kind of like the mafia, there will be unspoken rules and codes, and that sort of shattered all of them. It was poorly handled. I strongly suspect that there is going to be, given the blowback that we're having, there is going to be some modifications to their announcements, be it modifications to the deal, to their release schedule, but we've not heard the last of it. And I do believe in what Ava was saying earlier, that it cannot possibly be the end of theatrical, simply because I believe it is in our cultural DNA to go in these dark rooms and experience a story, a spectacle, an emotional journey with a bunch of strangers. And I don't care how good technology will get. I don't care how big our screens will get at home. There is no substitute for it. And I don't see it changing within our lifetime. If like people were like, oh, theater is dead. Well, guess what? It's not. The theatrical release schedule will be modified in some way, shape, or form. Obviously, you should also touched upon the window getting shorter, but it will come back. I think 2022 is a more realistic estimate. I think it is going to come back. Clearly, I don't see other studios jumping on that bandwagon very quickly and just saying, "Oh, we're going to dump everything." So Sony's going to sell all their movies to Amazon, and Disney's going to put everything on Disney Plus. I think this was a very reactive measure, and obviously, there is some validity to what they did, but they also overcorrected. Mm-hmm. So I don't see this fundamentally reshaping our business in any kind of permanent way.
Right. No, I agree. I think the communal experience is definitely something that you can't sort of replicate, no matter how big your home theater is.
See my problem with that?
And actually, I'm going to make a quick prediction. I suspect them when theaters do reopen, and sort of going with Trace Coachella theory, which actually I quite loved, and I'm going to start using it from now on. It's a very, very good indicator. I think we're going to see a surge in theater movie going, because I think people are starved not only for new content, people are just starved for a sense of community. I actually, kind of weirdly enough, I haven't done one of those in a while. So I'm like, oh, it's just kind of nice to see people and interact with people. So and now imagine doing that in person over something that fundamentally brings people together in the way that movies do. I think we're going to see a surge on movie going that will, for a period of time, will actually be greater than it was pre-COVID. Mm-hmm. But that's my prediction, or at least my hope.
Mm-hmm. Paul, you wanted to interject?
Well, I agree with everyone, what everyone's saying about the movie-going experience and the communalness, and I do think there'll be a surge. My cynical brain goes back to what I said earlier, is the people that are in charge don't care about any of that. They care about money. And if you look at the evolution of theatrical release features over the past 15 years specifically, you know, what I love to refer to as the Michael Douglas movie, it doesn't exist anymore. You know, theater releases have been going to the giant movies, the tentpole movies. And I think that, again, what this is going to show the people in charge is that, wow, look at the money we can save with prints and advertising. Look at the money we can save with the whole residual situation. Look, it's all about profit for them. And theatrical release is not a good profit model unless you're talking about the movies that bring in $300, $400, $500, $600 million. And that's why they will spend 40% of a budget on prints and advertising. And I think what's going to happen is the theater experience will come back, and I think there'll be a surge, because I think everybody, Alex and everybody, is saying is exactly right. People are going to want to have that experience again because it is so special. But how it's already been shrinking, you know, to the Marvel movies, the Nolan movies, the, you know, it's, I think it's going to become even more that the theater going experience is going to end up being specifically event oriented films. But the positive side of that, in my opinion, is I think movies being made specifically for streaming is going to bring back the Michael Douglas movie, you know, the movies that can be made for $30 to $90 million, which really have had a really hard time the last decade and a half. That's going to come back because they're going to put them up on Amazon and Netflix and now Hulu and everything. I just think it all comes down to money. And as romantic as the theater going experiences is, I don't think the people in charge, when they look at the balance sheets, are going to say, oh, you know, well, let's release that $80 million film and spend, you know, $32.5 million on prints and advertising and stuff. Or they can say, let's sell it to Netflix.
Mm-hmm. Ava, you look like you had something to add to that.
Yeah, I mean, there's a whole giant window of movies that have been getting so hard, that have been just so hard to make, you know? And I think also the advent of such great television has also taken, like, I don't know that you need to make A Few Good Men anymore as a theatrical film or as a film when you have amazing courtroom dramas or frankly, you're getting Aaron Sorkin in a variety of different ways, you know? So, you know, do you still need those films? And I think we haven't needed those for a long time, but, you know, I wonder in a year or two, would the next John Wick franchise be theatrical or would it be streaming? Like the movies that fit in that category, the original moderately priced, as it were, you know, I'm thinking 40 to 70, meaning moderately priced, you know, but I don't know. For me, it's like, as long as folks are working and we're getting stuff made and people can see it, like, that's what it's about. You know, we're all just trying to, you know, tell stories. You know, none of us are frontline workers or whatever. Or back when I was an agent and people would be screaming at me because I didn't give them a spec script for this territory, and I could care less because they're going to call me again when I have the next thing, because I always had, I like to think, good things. Mm-hmm. So it's, you know, it's, and I kept trying to remind them, it's like, you know, we're not saving lives. We're just trying to entertain the people who do, right? So it's, I think as long as we're able to make stuff and get it to people and entertain them, and streaming exists because there was a vacuum otherwise. Mm-hmm. And as long as we're able to kind of cover these and make the stuff, like, you know, I'm excited. Like a lot of the stuff that I live in, it's not giant $100 million movies, you know? I represent intellectual property, and that some of that might be there, but even not all of that lives in that space either. But I'll never forget it. I remember being, when I was back at ICM, a colleague and I were covering a major, major studio, and we were sitting in the hallway waiting for our next meeting with another executive, and the head of the studio walked by, who we've known for a long time, and that head of the studio was just like, we were like, oh, hey, dude, what's going on? Like, how have you been? You know, how's everything going? He's like, oh, I'm good. You know, just, you know, we're like, well, what are you looking for? What do you need? You know, that's what we're here for. And he's like, guys, I really need more billion-dollar franchises. And we're like, oh, my God, we've been sitting on so many. I'm so sorry. We've been holding up the side of our coffee table with all of them. Like, it's just, you know, this was 10 years ago, by the way, too. So nothing, that shrinking has happened a long time ago. It might shrink a little bit further, but you know, we'll still have indie art house theaters. I still feel really lucky that I got to see a movie like Portrait of a Lady on Fire on a big screen. I still feel really lucky I've gotten to see some of these indies in this way, and I will continue to seek them out, and they'll continue to have opportunity if people continue to seek them out. But yeah, I feel in many ways, once we can make the deal making make sense and that, you know, folks aren't getting screwed in that sort of way, it's all mostly back-end residual-related things like that, and the WGA has been very much at the forefront in fighting for that for quite some time, then we can just get back to just making movies and making great TV and telling great stories and valuing original content again.
Uh-huh. And Ian, as a writer who has a big budget film in the pipeline, what's your whole take on it?
My take on the Warner situation?
Yeah, and how you see it going forward.
So I think that part of the what makes the Warner thing such a fiasco is that you're going to have this whole generation of filmmakers who don't trust that studio anymore. Like, you know, all these directors who had to find out on Twitter that, you know, the movie they thought was going to be up on big screens globally is going to be, you know, getting a day and date where people are going to be watching it like on their phones. And I think it's really hard to rebuild that trust. And, you know, Warner Brothers was like it was the place to be if you were a filmmaker who was making popular entertainment that had, you know, your own stamp on it. Like, they were more director friendly than just about any other studio in town. And, you know, with one decision, they've managed to undermine that reputation. So I think it's going to take a lot of work to build that trust back. Like I'm working on a project over there right now with a director whose movie just got dumped to HBO Max as part of that deal. And I haven't asked him about this, but I wonder, you know, when he sees his future, when he imagines his future, does he see himself sticking with the studio that did this to him, or is he going to go elsewhere? And that brings me to a larger point, which is, as happy as I am that there are multiple outlets for the stuff that we make, that there are now, you know, lots of different ways to get lots of different types of movies in front of eyeballs, the fact that I can't escape is that we have yet to see a straight-to-streaming movie that has had some kind of huge seismic cultural impact the way like a major theatrical release does. You know, there's been ones that people like, there's been ones that have been very good, but there's been nothing that that left a huge mark in our sort of collective consciousness, that, you know, the type of movie that inspires future generations to make movies. And until that happens, I don't know how many directors are going to be terribly excited about seeing their movie go straight to streaming.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It's still going to feel a little bit farm team.
Right. Right. We've just been joined by two new guests. Mr. Drew Chapman, writer, producer, showrunner on such series as The Resident, The Assets, and Legends, and the author of the Garrett Riley series from Simon & Schuster. Welcome, Drew.
Thank you. Hi, nice to be here.
And Lindsay Devlin, screenwriter of Devil's Due and former CAA colleague of mine. Welcome, Lindsay, all the way from London. Or what part of England do you live in now?
We're right outside Oxford, actually.
Outside Oxford, England. So welcome. Thank you for joining us. The first question I'm going to actually dive into with both Drew and Lindsay, we've been asking everyone, because it's been such a wonderful year, what's one really good thing that happened to you in 2020? Just one piece of good news that you have to share with us. So I'll start with Drew first.
Well, that's hard. Got to search tough. I would say that the pandemic forced both of my kids to come back and live with me at home, which was like just fabulous. And also the pandemic, you know, I mean, I'm running a television show from my bedroom or my backyard right now, and we can do it. Like, it can actually be done. I mean, it's hard, but, you know, like, we don't all have to go back into the office, and that's kind of revelatory. You know, maybe I can go live outside of Oxford. I like that idea, and just run a show from England. I mean, I think about that all the time. My wife and I talk about it constantly. Okay, so next season we're doing this from Barcelona, right? Like, yeah, maybe Barcelona. That sounds pretty good. So I would say it's those two things: family at home, and that you don't have to go into a workplace, has been really a surprise and a wonderful one.
And Lindsay?
Yeah, what a crazy time. I mean, it's really weird because we're so far away from everybody, but like, we're not any farther away than we would have been, honestly, anywhere else is the weirdest thing. So other than the time change, yeah, life is so Zoom, you know, Zoom-rific these days. Let's see, for me, it's a little bit like Drew just said, I think slowing down has forced us as a family and just as individuals to reconnect with what's really important. And for us as a family, we've always been really busy and really schedule-y and really let's go to the museums and let's do this. And honestly, all we've been doing is long walks in parks and like really community-based stuff, like helping our neighbors with, you know, gardening and just, I mean, it's, I wish I could just, you know, have the ability right now to write about it, but I hope someday I can. I think there's going to be such amazing, interesting art that comes out of this time. Probably already has, but will be for time to come. So yeah, I feel like it just really forced me to be more introspective, slow down, and I think I will never take for granted a hug ever.
Yeah, ever. Right.
So I don't think I've had any good news. I think the good news is we might have a vaccine soon. That's yeah, fingers crossed.
Yeah.
Maybe I'll see Los Angeles in 2021. That's my hope.
Yeah, let's hope. I wanted to sort of springboard into something else. Lindsay brought up a great thought of some of the great stories and things coming out of this in the future. But let's talk about 2020 and some of the great things we've seen. Shows, films, books you've read, things like that, stuff that you found to be really special in 2020, because this really is something that's carried a lot of people through. The Zoom and the communication that's been so instrumental in keeping people, the social connections together of everybody out there. And then the art, the films, again, the books, the TV shows, sort of enriching people's souls because you can't go out and do other things. So you find those connections through, again, you know, TV shows and through Zoom. So what are the favorite shows, films, books, whatever you've read this year? And I'm going to start with Rob, since we haven't heard from Rob in a minute. Rob, what's some of the best things you've partaken in this year that you want to share?
Yeah, all right. Well, it's interesting because as we're talking about how the industry is changing and everything, the biggest seismic shift I saw this year was Queen's Gambit. Hmm. This notion of like, hey, if I do it as a movie, which Scott Frank is like, if I do it as a movie, it's just going to be about, oh, it's this girl fighting the Russians and whatever. It's going to be, you know, there is, although you have 2 hours, feature films are very limited, you know, and this notion that you can have a hybrid of a 7-hour movie that will be enthralling is great, you know, and I think that, you know, as we're talking about what is the new normal, I think a lot of people, unfortunately, over the break, bought bigger TV sets, right? You know, everybody is used to the notion now of Netflixing and chilling, and this hybrid of the home theater, you know, better speakers and stuff like that. It's there. It's there to stay. Those things aren't going away. So we're gonna have that, and exploring new ways to tell stories is a great, or to exploit what we have, which is, you know, you're going to be sitting around for a good long time in a comfortable place. You can pause whenever you want. Can we tell an interesting story in that time? The other part of it, which is interesting to me, is that I'm involved in a bunch of projects, but two of the projects that I'm working on right now, one is an animated film, writing and directing, and that's 2023. And then the other is an old sci-fi film, which is 2023, right? So from a practical standpoint, the industry is, it's going to be what it's going to be. You know, that there will always, especially post-pandemic, there will be a escapist fair will be, will be on the auction block. Everybody's going to want to get back into something that's going to not remind them of, you know, what's going on outside. So that's happening. And then, like I say, the fun will be what happens with this new, with the new normal? You know, how do we entertain people? How do we get people out of their heads, not thinking about how difficult it is to buy a carton of milk at the, you know, how do we get people out of their heads and into something that can make them laugh? You know, we don't feel funny as we're living it, but as storytellers, it's really, really important right now to get people laughing, get people enjoying their lives for just a half, you know, just that 2 hour spot. I did have a question for Ava though, that with the Warner Brothers thing, you mentioned very briefly that the notion of, you know, the box office bonuses. And I keep thinking, as more of these movies are coming out, at some time or another, they're going to have to open their books. You know, there's always been this kind of like, ooh, you know, streaming, the money comes from, you know, Elf and Magic. And so at some point or another, somebody's going to have to figure out a model for what is a successful streamer and what is not. You know, was Mank successful or wasn't it? You know,
they also like hiding, you know, that information, right? They don't want anybody to know. They want everything to be a success.
Just
came up actually with clients of mine who also happen to be very, very good friends, had a movie, a romantic comedy for Netflix that came out a month or so ago called Love Guaranteed. And one of them was telling me, like, this is the biggest residual check we've gotten. So clearly this movie has done exceptionally well. Meanwhile, we're fighting with them on like something for like a fourth movie for them right now that is like an EP credit with like no fee attached to it. And we're having to fight for this. And it's like, and they just got some massive thing and they don't share the information even with their producers very much. They don't share, like, you know, you get notes based on data mining. You know, it's just the things that have happened with all of this and like biggest completion percentages and this and that. And all, like, it's just it's an interesting thing. I don't know how we do. I don't know that we do without having, like, you know, the guilds collectively forcing their hands in some way, you know, depending on, I don't know if there's, you know, Nielsen is changing their model. I wish I knew, because frankly, we would ask for more with proof of success. So we're always going to want more and we're always going to fight to get more money for people. But it's hard when they try to hide it. I think we've had some help in terms of not having to showcase quotes. You know, there's some moments where that doesn't help, but more often than not, we're able to kind of push and ask for more without having to showcase something. But if you also have a quote that your client gives you permission to fight for, it helps to have that sort of empirical proof too. But I wish we knew more about that stuff, because it would ask us to be that much more sharky if we have proof behind it. So,
because we know that they know, right? They know.
Oh, they know. They know.
Watching what and how much that person paid to watch that minute of a product. They know. They have it on their books, and they're just like, oh, good. More for us.
It's also so, why, like, the windows for post-production is a bit longer, right? For places like Netflix, you know, because they're doing 20 different one sheets, because depending on the shows that you've watched before, this actor, this character might resonate with you more. So that's on your front page versus four of the other people on it. Or it's one of these seven trailers maybe that goes, like, it is all through that constant, it's constant feedback depending on what you watch. So it's interesting. I think they're going to fight it as long as they can. And unless we, you know, force their hand, and by we, I don't think it's sadly on my end of things, it's going to, I think, come down to the strength of the guilds and ideally, you know, including IATSE, all four of them kind of combining and working together to open up their books.
Yeah.
And Trey, I'm going to jump to you, favorite shows, films, books, but also I'm assuming you're going to have some great music suggestions for us. and if you haven't, Tradio 2020, Trey's annual year-end music podcast, which I was just listening to. I'm about halfway through it before we got on. We'll have a link below if you want to check that out. But Trey,
it was a true labor of love this year, man.
I bet.
No, you know, look, there has been, thankfully, in large part due to talented folks like everybody I'm sharing a screen with right now, like, there has been no shortage of great stuff to watch as a viewer. And, you know, I think I've tended to sort of seek out viewing experiences that really take me out of my living room as much as possible. So, you know, in that sense, you know, I was a big fan of Unorthodox and Tehran. You know, Rob mentioned Queen's Gambit, certainly. Even The Mandalorian, which I love. Like, anything that just takes me out of this room, it has been good. But also, you know, maybe as too much of an empath, you know, as a sap of sorts, like, a lot of the documentary fare has really struck a chord with me too. I guess in the same ways, allowing me to sort of feel like I'm living other people's lives to a certain extent. But, you know, I know The Last Dance had me from beginning to end. The Taste the Nation, Padma Lakshmi, food series was fantastic. I still have a lump in my throat from watching last night the Bee Gees' How Can You Mend a Broken Heart documentary, which is just extraordinary. So those are things that I have enjoyed immensely. There's been no shortage of it. And then, yeah, the music, you know, look, I actually, during the pandemic, I sat for several days and tried to create the comprehensive list of concerts I can remember seeing in my life, and I tapped out around the 600 mark. That's a big part of how I spend my time and whatever extra dollars I have every year is seeing live music. So definitely missing that in a big way. And so I've leaned even further into trying to consume all different kinds of music, and it's all there, man. It's 2+ hours of stuff in the podcast I dropped last night. So I you've got the link. Thank you for that. And anybody who wants to check that out can check it out. But yeah, that's the good thing. Another one of the silver linings is while we're all stuck here staring at screens, at least there has been no shortage, in my opinion, of great things to watch. One interesting thing, though, is, you know, I and I'm not complaining because a paycheck's a paycheck, but I got a nice gig a few months ago just prior to the pandemic that is based on some IP but it's a dystopian story. You know, 15 minutes in the future after a complete global financial meltdown. And to then have to render those services and tell that story while we have been going through what we have been going through was not easy. It was definitely pouring salt on my wounds. So I talk about taking long walks in parks, Lindsay. Like, I've had to, like, do it several times a day just to sort of cleanse my soul of that ugliness. So that's all the more reason why watching something like The Mandalorian, where I can just go away, has been key for me.
Mm-hmm. Well, real quick, Trey, you know what I think stood out for me this year to add to the list you guys have all said is Ted Lasso, for example.
Yeah.
I can't great even show. Say like how much I love that show and just optimism and joy and fun. I don't know that I've seen a half hour that kind of did that for me in a long time.
Agreed.
Drew, what are some of the great shows or films or music you've listened to or books you've read this year?
Well, no music, but, you know, I would say that for me, I'm always watching shows and thinking about both what Trey was talking about getting out of myself, but I'm also thinking about what are things... What do they inspire in me to create other things? And the thing I've noticed this year that I really think is an amazing trend is, not to get too in the weeds of production, but shows that are set overseas, financed overseas, show up on Netflix. He mentioned a couple, Dark from Germany, or, you know, Call My Agent from France, or, you know, even on HBO, like, you know, I May Destroy You, or things that take you into a glimpse of another world and that are way other people live. Like, I watched I May Destroy You. I didn't even love the show necessarily, but to watch a show about Black lives in London, I was like, I'll watch this forever, like, happily just, like, indulge in that. But I also think, as people who create television and create movies, the future is not doing what I'm doing now, working for a big network show where you spend lots of money and get mediocre ratings, honestly. The future is spending not a lot of money, doing it with money from lots of different places, and combining talent from lots of different countries and telling stories that people haven't seen. And, you know, the quality doesn't have to be like absolutely spectacular. It just has to be good enough, and the story has to be entertaining enough and to draw you in emotionally or plot-wise so that you're loving this experience. And to me, the last year has shown that that exists. And it doesn't just exist, it's thriving. And everybody I talk to, like looking to develop new projects, is, can we, you know, would you be willing to fly to Lithuania to talk to people who are going to give us $5 million? And then can you go to Israel and talk to, you know, like, and I'm like, yeah, absolutely. I think that's fantastic. I'm so interested in that. And I find those, you know, that sort of, it's like the world music thing. It's just like building on all these great cultures and all these great stories and finding ways to tell stories to Americans and to everybody overseas too. So I love that. And I know that's a vague answer in terms of what are my favorite things, but it's a narcissistic answer in terms of what am I going to do next? So.
No, I mean, it's great. Wait, and you gave, go ahead, Rob.
It has been really kind of uplifting to see, you know, with what Andrew's talking about, the amount of calls I'm getting, just people looking for diverse content. You know, where people are saying, hey, Rob, remember that thing we turned down like, you know, 2 years ago, you know, where we said that there was no way that a black person could ever, you know, and everybody would want to see that movie. Well, we kind of want to see, you know, did you ever, you know, can we take another look at that thing? And those things are moving. It's kind of remarkable. I mean, luckily, I've written a lot of them on spec. So they're around. So they're, you know, they can be bought. And I hope that this is not a moment. I hope that this is a sea change, that our curiosity will be rewarded by us getting more curious about other cultures, about other, you know, the way other people live. But it is uplifting, and I hope we have evolved.
If I could throw in a story, to a real life story, and I will name no names because I'll get fired, but. 3 years ago, it was laid down as a fiat that the leads in unnamed show had to be white and all the corollary players, their secondary people, could be color. And now it is literally the opposite. Now we are replacing people, and it's like those people have to be people of color, and we don't care about, you know, what the sort of Caucasian demographic is of the viewership of the show or your cast. So like,
do you think that's enlightenment or do you think that's enlightenment or do you think that's just business?
I think that the two go hand in hand.
Yeah.
Add fear, the truth. Add fear as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. All those things. But I hope for enlightenment, but business will do fine. So
going back to favorite shows, films, books, Lindsay, what have you been partaking in? What have you been enjoying?
Yeah, I mean, just reflecting on what everyone's saying, I think the most striking thing about this experience and this year is my living room is populated with the most diverse looking faces and lives that I've ever sort of seen. I just watched the 40-year-old version last night. We watched I May Destroy You. Mandalorian is filled with the most kick-ass women, and you know, just it's just really striking. We're also consuming so much more, so it's just like in my face more. But I constantly turn to my husband and say, like, this is just amazing, and I do hope it's just a sea change because people are responding to it. It's working. It's not just some. I hope it's so great because my 6-year-old is watching Mandalorian with us. And he just accepts and actually said to us, he goes, the women are the best fighters. And we're like, yeah, they are. So it's just so great to see after so long in Hollywood it being all white and male to see this change and long time coming, way overdue, obviously. But I just think the storytelling is richer for it. I think Netflix is giving a platform for, you know, something like the 40-year-old version to exist and to be made. And I'm definitely in a weird bubble over here in England whereby both just being far away and also my career is in a little bit of a standstill right now, not just COVID related, but I'm now the primary caretaker for my 2-year-old at the moment. So I like things will pop up on Netflix and I'll be like, when was this made? How did this get made? This is amazing. So I'm sure you guys have, Ava, you probably have lots of stories of how some of these things are getting made or not made, or the calls you're getting as a rep, how different that might be from, you know, a few years ago even, but it's been wonderful and really inspiring to see. Mm-hmm. And I hope for a lot more of it in 2021 and beyond. I think my favorites right now, honestly, like there's a lot of darker stuff we've consumed. And so I'm late to coming to Schitt's Creek. So thank God for Schitt's Creek. Like it just makes me smile, just makes me so happy. And we're only halfway through. So I know we've got a lot more good stuff to come, but so we'll watch something like The Boys and I'll be like, oh, and then I'll put on Schitt's Creek and be like, okay. Yeah,
that's such a good show.
I mean, almost everything I've watched is great for a reason or another. Mm-hmm. Or I find something to really respond to in it. Like I would never have watched The Boys, and yet all my angst about America like sort of got to explode onto the screen with The Boys. So I don't know. I just feel like creatively, I'm expanding my own self as well, watching all these things, because I think I realized I was a little bit narrow in my own viewing, and now I've just been like, just bring it, just let me just eat it up. So I don't think I answered your question.
Sort of. I mean, we're just, what are some great things you've seen or read or listened to this year? That's all.
Yeah, it's great.
Yeah, there you go.
Normal people.
Yeah. No, it's great. I love that show. I found it this year too. So that's great. Alex, what are you watching? What have you seen that's amazing?
Well, first of all, I have to say Queen's Gambit, which already was mentioned. I feel like that's actually going to be the John Wick of the moment, where clearly it's having a seismic effect culturally. I was reading that chess sales are up, books and chess sales up, chess.com, massive influx of new users. And I am sure this is not the last that we saw of chess-themed movies and TV projects. Actually, for years, I've been wanting to do a story in chess, which I sort of lived in part. Like, nobody's interested. Nobody cares. I'm like, yes, now 2021, I'm going to sell this. Definitely that's the one that is going to have long legs in terms of our business. Nobody's actually mentioned The Great, which is something that I've discovered this year, and talk about like something, and you know, as a writer where you just go, oh man, that is so deliciously written, and this Hamilton-esque take on Russian history, which is utterly anachronistic, utterly irreverent, yet is so utterly enjoyable, with just career redefining performances, as it was the case with Nick Hold, and where the writer is the invisible star of the show. I just loved it and cannot wait for season two. People who, I think Trey mentioned Unorthodox, which I also loved. And I guess, again, the trend is the stories that a few years ago you'd be like, oh yeah, no way in the world, period story about this alcoholic, drug addicted, mentally non-Italy there, female chess player, or this young woman trying to flee her life in the Orthodox community, where a show with subtitles like Money Heist, no. And what is clear is, I feel like the more weird and unique the show, the more undeniable it is. So it's like, oh yeah, she's a hard as nails cop, and she is a tough lawyer, and together, like, no. Those days are long gone, and that's what's exciting, where, the stories that you would say, well, this is interesting, but there is no way it's going to find its way onto a screen, now it can. In terms of and in terms of books, I actually, there's a series that I've been following, post Game of Thrones. I've just been hungry for another fantasy series. And I don't know if you guys read Joe Abercrombie, a British writer. He created something called the First Law Universe. And it is freaking good, man. It's really, really awesome. So kind of begins similar to Game of Thrones, the sort of medieval style fantasy. But two new books just came out, and it sort of goes into what if the world of Game of Thrones developed technology, so now we're into Victorian age, and he's doing his homage to Dickens and all of a twist and all that stuff. It is really, really good, and I've just been vastly enjoying the series. And to anybody who is saying, "Well, Game of Thrones kind of ran its course," what's another book series I can read that treads in the similar territory but does something unique? I highly recommend that.
Mm-hmm. Great. And lastly, Paul, what have you seen, read, listened to this year that you found absolutely amazing?
For me, we already talked about it. When I discovered Ted Lasso this year, it was the perfect time because it was one of my darker valleys of 2020. And this show came on and somebody said, "You should watch the show." And they told me just because I'm a football fan, soccer fan. And it filled me with so much joy because, you know, there were no real tropes. There were no villains. It was like, yes, you can be a decent human being and you can have stories with decent human characters. And it's still funny. And it's still, I could go on and on about it. I loved Prentice Penny's Uncorked. If anyone saw that, it was this little film he made for Netflix. And I thought it was really lovely. About wine, but really about people. My second favorite television show of all time ended in 2020. It went out beautifully, I thought, BoJack Horseman. That show, I don't think there has been a more accurate take on our industry in the history of, you know, screen than BoJack Horseman. Documentaries that I loved. The year started off so optimistic for me with Tiger King. I mean, come on. do we remember when we thought that was as crazy as anything could possibly get? Remember when we felt that way for 5 seconds? I love that. I loved Michelle McNamara's I'll Be Gone in the Dark. That was beautifully done documentary. Blew my mind. And and the thing I just saw recently, as far as, you know, I get inspired by actors a lot and performances and the other people on there. I get inspired by music, obviously, more than anything, but directors, I mean, costume designers inspire me. And I just saw last week Sound of Metal, and Riz Ahmed's performance in that, to me, I haven't seen anything to come close to that in a long, long time. Just watching that film just for his performance alone, it was staggering to me. And I'm a huge music fan, so there was that, but and it's just beautifully done too. I highly recommend that.
Mm-hmm.
Those are kind of things. Book-wise, I just finished reading Interior Chinatown, Charles Yu book, which is fantastic in just the way it's written, because it's a novel, it's a screenplay, it's a memoir, it's a poem. It's hilarious, and it's you know, opened a world up to me. Like somebody else was saying earlier about how we're experiencing these different cultures and worlds, thankfully, finally. And Interior Chinatown is this novel that it's this, you know, the struggling Asian American actor and his plight. And it's just, I just thoroughly enjoyed it.
Mm-hmm. Before we move on to the next question, which would be things you'd like to see in 2021, not things you predict, but things you would like to see both in the industry and just in general. I wanted to jump back to Ava really quickly. And a lot of people on the panel have been talking about wanting to get away, wanting to an escape from COVID. But I know also that a lot of Lindsay brought it up as well, a lot of great stories coming from this pandemic, and not not necessarily just about the pandemic, although a lot of people just have time, so they're writing stuff, but specifically also about the pandemic. After 9/11, you know, you have great films after any sort of moment in history that affects so many people, you're going to have great stories. So I want to ask Ava, when, I'm sure you've seen them already. I'm sure they're coming across your desk. I'm sure they're being emailed to you incessantly. When do you think, for those writers out there who are pounding with their keyboards, their experience during COVID or their great story about COVID, when is too soon? I had heard a story, and I don't know how true it was, that Shameless, this season of Shameless, actually is the first to deal with COVID. So I want to ask, Ava, what your thoughts are on writers out there who are writing stories about this.
I don't know. I think I put out the first week of, maybe the second week of March.
I remember that tweet. Twitter,
like, do not write a pandemic plague show or movie. I don't want to see it. Nobody wants to see it. Mm-hmm. I think that's still mostly true. I think for me, what's been interesting and where I've seen, I thankfully haven't seen anything specifically pandemic-y on my desk, and I don't really want to. What I'm more interested in, and what I do think I've seen clients do and other writers do, is address the themes that have resonated to them during this pandemic. The emotional things, the existential elements, the relationship elements, it's stuff like that. So it's not about, you know, sitting at home and finding love between balconies or something, you know, like there have been some of those out there. That's not of interest to me. But I've read some scripts that, you know, really delve into some dark terrain or some really emotional ones and resonate in a way that's, I think, far more universal and frankly makes it more timeless. You know, that to me is just much more compelling and interesting. And that's also much more human and more broadly relatable, because one person's experience here, you know, just even my experience in LA is going to be different than Huntington Beach, right? It's going to be just a little bit different, let alone Florida, let alone other places around the world. So I think it's too narrow to write something just about your own maybe solo experience in that way, which is another reason why I wouldn't recommend doing it. One of the favorite scripts I've read from a client this year was just a client who was watching all the Charlie Brown specials this summer with his now 4-year-old, and realizing just how awful everybody was to Charlie Brown, and just how terrible they all are, and just like not having watched it since he was, you know, since he was a kid. And so he got inspired and all of a sudden sends the script, and I just was so enthralled by it. But it was basically kind of applying the big chill to Charlie Brown. And it's the adult Peanuts characters who all come together after Charlie Brown has just committed suicide. And it's fucked up and dark and weird, and I freaking loved it. And I'm so excited to start sharing this with people, but the thematics of it, and it was just so emotionally resonant to play, it's not something we'll probably ever get made, but it's just one of those calling card type of scripts, and he's needed one of those. Maybe, you know, it's been maybe a year or two, maybe 2 years since he's had one. So, but like, to me, that's what's interesting. And he's written two other things since then that have also these resonating emotional thematics in different worlds and scopes. And I think that's where artists should capitalize.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So now, things that we'd all like to see in 2021, not predictions, but just things that in an ideal world you would like to see, both in the industry and just in general. I'm going to start with Drew. What would you like to see in 2021, sir?
I was worried that you were going to start with me. I mean, God.
I can come back to you.
No, I mean, I think the things I'd like to see are honestly just normalcy. I'm desperate for, like, you know, I a lot of the stuff I write is geopolitical, and I can't. Like, it's to write geopolitical in the Trump era is just impossible. You cannot compete with the clown car. So you have to just step away from it. So I've stepped away from it. So, like, normalcy would be nice. Just so I didn't have to have two bourbons before bed every night. That would be fantastic.
Trey, what do you want to see in 2021?
Oh, goodness. Yeah, some semblance of peace inside the Republic. Specific to the industry, I'll tell you one thing I'd like to see because it impacts all of us. Look, I'm a writer by trade, but I'm an avocational performer and a member of SAG-AFTRA. And the fact that they have dropped 3,500 of their performers and 2,800 of their dependents off of the SAG-AFTRA healthcare plan is just completely reprehensible in every way. And it worries me as someone who has just gotten a wife through a bone marrow transplant and leukemia treatments, all of which are grossly expensive and none of which would have been possible without the thankful solvency of the WGA or PWGA health plan. It worries me when I see any of our trade unions in this town treating their members that way, because it sends a message to all the others that's an acceptable practice. And so I know there's a class action suit that has been filed. I would really like to see that decision reexamined and for those folks to keep their health care. In the broader sense, of course, I want us all to have health care in this country. It's unimaginable that this is not a guarantee for us, but I'll try and avoid the larger political dialogue. It's just something that this is a very small town, right? I grew up in a small town, but I always say to my SC students, there's no smaller town than Hollywood. But yeah, what impacts SAG impacts all the rest of us and vice versa. And so that's something that I would like to see changed in 2020.
Mm-hmm. Well, but Trump has the best plan, right? Who knew it's this complicated?
Yeah.
Oh God.
I don't want to push Drew back to the bourbon this early. It's not noon yet. So,
okay. Lindsay, what would you like to see in 2021?
Well, I mean, other than the vaccine and yes, Trump out and all that good stuff. I think in our business, I want to see that what we were talking about before, the trend not be a trend. I want to see these diverse stories continue. Particularly, I'd like to see more women behind the camera. It's, you know, we still have a long way to go. We still need more female storytellers. So it's great to see more females starring in things and diverse females at that. But I still want to see more of my female compatriots writing and directing. Personally for myself, I just want to get more creative. I think I've been in a little bit of a paralyzed rut with COVID and just for a few other creative reasons. And so for myself, I'm setting that goal just to say F it and let it all come out. Hopefully some good things for myself as well. I really, it's been a strange year. Everyone's cut off. People are struggling emotionally and mentally and financially. And I just hope that there's a lot of hope to be had in 2021. Unfortunately I have to run. I've got a 6-year-old screaming up there. I'm so sorry to
know,
but it's really good to see everybody in Los Angeles. Ava,
say hi to Cole. I miss you guys.
Good to see you, Lindsay.
I miss you a lot. And just everybody, it's just good to see you, meet you. Happy holidays.
Happy holidays. Happy New Year. Thank you, Lindsay.
Thank you for having me. Thank you so much, everybody.
Alex, have I gotten to you? Yeah, no, I did get to you. I didn't get to you. Alex. things you'd like to see in 2021.
Return to normalcy and return to decency and empathy. Mm. I mean, look, I think normalcy is going to take a while. As I said, I don't think that's going to happen in 2021, but at least we can start walking. But boy, we are not, this was a hard year and we didn't really make it easy for ourselves, did we? I feel like as we begin to crawl out of the pit we've sort of dug ourselves into, I would just love to see a little bit more decency, a little bit more empathy, a little bit less venom on, quite frankly, on both sides. this applies to our world in general, but also specifically in our business. I've also, as I think Ava said earlier in the conversation, we're not the frontline workers. I know we're treating it like it's life and death, but at the end of the day, hey, we're just telling stories for a living. We are court jesters trying to amuse those around us and distract them with and educate them occasionally with our fables. And I would just love to see a little bit more of us coming together as a community, because I sort of feel like emblematic of the state of our country, Hollywood is very much divided right now. And I would love to see just all of us coming more together as creators, as storytellers, and as a community.
Mm-hmm. That's great. Mr. Edwards, what would you like to see in 2021? Yes. Hear me, Rob? There we go.
Exactly. Where's that button? And then of course, my little side menu shows up right when I want to click the thing. So, sorry. But, I think that I'm a little bit with everybody else that there is. Well, here's how I'll depart. A lot of us want to return to normal want to return to where we were before. Which, you know, unfortunately for Black folk, wasn't all that great. You know, March was not a great, you know, I'm still getting pulled over for no reason at all. So, and I'm a nice guy. But I'm actually hoping that there was an evolution during the time that all the protests and everything like that sunk into enough people. You know, that a lot of the conversations I've been having over Zooms during quarantine have been really good. You know, a lot of friends of mine have been like, wow, okay, wait. So LA is only 30% white. You know, like, how is that my office is 100% white? Like, yes, exactly. We live in a, you know, there's something's going on there, you know, some manipulations, let's say. So those things are changing, which is good. And I'm hoping that we, at the end of this, like, we come out of it better. You know, that when the sun shines again and we're all kind of walking around, that we're just, we have evolved. We're a little bit, we will look at people in a different way and kind of, you know, reach out as opposed to like, you know, I can do without the purse clutching, you know, on the elevators and stuff like that. And hopefully those days are gone. And I think, like, it's interesting to see what's been going on the last couple of days. Where it's like, you know, when you're kind of, you have the flu or whatever, and then like the last day of the flu, and you're taking whatever you're taking, and then the last day of it, like, you're sick as a dog, and then you wake up the next morning, and you're like, oh, okay, you're drenched in sweat, but you feel great. And hopefully that's what all of this, what we're dealing with between now and January 20th, you know, there's going to be a lot of crap in the streets and a lot of, you know, whatever, and people are randomly stabbing people and stuff like that. And then hopefully the sun shines and we go, okay, we are now, you know, we have shed the cocoon, and now we are, you know, now we are the butterflies, and we're going to kind of go off and go. So that is my deep hope. That's my Christmas wish and my New Year's.
All wrapped up into one.
Yep.
So we've heard empathy, decency, universal healthcare, evolution. What do you have, Paul?
You know, for me, and look, well, this is our wish list, so I don't hold out much hope for this, but like if I could have one wish for 2021, it would be for the end of, you know, this hate and ignorance being empowered and emboldened, and I put that on the media. You know, when after January 20th, that clown's going to continue to have rallies and events, and the media is going to cover it, and he's going to be on Fox News, and he's going to be on all this. And if everyone would just ignore it, it would take so much of the juice out of those 74 million
poor, pathetic souls that voted for him. And I don't mean, I mean, this is obviously political, but I mean this from a human being standpoint and what we've talked about decency. And it's just, if the media would stop that every movie makes, every word out of his mouth is, oh, we got to cover it, you know, I think that would really help our society a lot. I mean, you can't even get me into the, you know, the people in the, in his own party, you know, that are standing with, you know, what put it, anyways, I'm not going to get into that because we all know, but it's just, I would love for the media to once, just once, you know, not feel like, hey, ratings, and put society maybe ahead of that. As for our business, I wish this every year. And it's simply that the buyers and the deal makers would stop being reactionary and stop, you know, like just find good stories and put them on the air and stop like, oh, Fleabag's on. So now everybody wants their Fleabag. Oh, George Floyd happened. Nobody wants to buy a cop show or anything with a law enforcement, you know, character in it. Like, it's just, and this has been the way the business has been forever. So it's not just a 2020 thing, but I wish for that every year, that reactionary buying would stop and that people would buy based on story and not based on, well, this is how I don't get fired.
Mm-hmm. Ava?
I mean, I think the guys have covered it and then some. I mean, I just want to believe in science and I want people to believe in truth and facts and, you know, empathy and kindness and, you know, all of those good things. And yeah, it's funny, Paul, we were saying, like, I stopped watching TV news November 9th of 2016 because of how complicit I found them to be. So as someone who volunteers a lot and banks and does all of that kind of stuff, and now this year probably threw more money than I did necessarily as much as my time as I did in the past. But you know, there is a level of responsibility and it's not just to shareholders. So it, I hope we have more of a balance of that. And I'm also really thrilled to see that, you know, yes, other stories, you know, and I think this merges both in life and in art. You know, we're just interested in seeing how other people live and what other experiences are. And I think, you know, the fact that like a show like Watchmen, which I you know, I'm a giant nerd, so I was a big fan, obviously, of the original graphic novel for a very, very long time since I was a kid. And then to see that as a sequel thing, and as a side note, Regina King can do no wrong. But I mean, she's just like, I mean, you know, just bow at that altar. But to have what happened, you know, as far as like Black Wall Street, and you have so many people go like, wait, what is that? That was real? Wait, what? You know, and having people realize that we've also only been taught a really specific point of view and an incredibly narrow one too, even within the Caucasian community, it's still a very narrow point of view, that this is the power art has, you know, is to raise some of these questions, to ask some of these things. And like, I'm even noticing it just for the last year and a half that a client of mine who's half Native American, like, oh, that's not the diversity we're looking for. It's only been in the last like 6, 8 months, year that people are like, oh, well, that's actually interesting. Like maybe we'll care about that now, you know? And it was like, we're only looking for this kind of point of view or this diversity. And as someone who's an immigrant and I wasn't born in this country and being Iranian American and all of these things and you know, maybe I'm less brown because I don't get as much sun as I used to, but you know, it's just nice to be able to have, you know, like right now I'm going to be speaking in the new year at the new Middle Eastern writers group that has been formed within the WGA and with folks I've known socially and some are Iranian, some are different backgrounds. And I'm thrilled to see that come in because while we technically don't count as our own, you know, minority, I think Arab and Iranian and just sort of more broadly Middle Eastern is seen as Caucasian. There's a cultural point of view. There's just life points of view and stuff like that. So my hope is that what we've seen progress over the last couple of years will continue and will continue to broaden stuff because what we're seeing in, you know, whether it's time periods or different points of view, that they're interesting, they're relatable, there's a humanity there, and that's also what makes them great art. And so the more we can see that, the more I hope it then seeps back to the kindness, because you're seeing Gen Z, who more often than not, I find very inspiring by and large, because they've grown up seeing diversity on Disney Channel, and they've grown up seeing this stuff. They're not thrown off by, you know, LGBTQ people and trans, whatever, that's no big deal. You know, it's a lot of the rest of us who unfortunately, you know, and the folks above, you know, above all of our pay grades who are in charge of these things, who are the ones who are still catching up, but we're already seeing the benefits of this art with this younger generation, and how, again, by and large, they're more open-minded than the one before. And that's because of folks on here and the ones in our circles who we try to advocate to tell interesting stories. So I just hope to see that trend continue.
Mm-hmm. And sort of wrapping it up, I want to ask you guys all for one, a New Year's resolution. And then also for those writers out there who thought 2020, this is, you know, at 2019's ending, 2020 is going to be my year, and then this happened. And so now they're going, 2021, that's going to be my year. What's one piece of advice you could give or to those writers out there who think, okay, 2021, that's going to be my year since 2020 wasn't? So a New Year's resolution and just a piece of advice or a good word for those writers out there who think 2021 will be the year for them. I will start with Trey.
Oh boy. Okay. My resolution is to try and pay more attention to my inner 12-year-old. I recently had a little back and forth in the most pleasantly delightful way on Twitter with Mark Hamill.
I saw that on Facebook. Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you. It was a big moment.
So cool. I think I put a bunch of like, oh my God, emojis on
it. Yeah. It was a big moment for me, but it was a big moment also in that it just reminded me like, that kid I was in 77, that's pretty much the kid that I usually channel when I sit down to write virtually anything. And yet the pressures of the pandemic and an industry shutdown and having everybody home and all those sorts of responsibilities and everything we've gone through personally as a family in the last few years, it's just like all of that stuff has a way of shoving that inner 12-year-old into the darkest recesses of the closet. So like I need to pull that kid back out again. And so that's my resolution to myself. You know, in terms of advice to anybody who's like, is 2021 finally going to be my year? I think that process has to begin with you saying, hell yes, 2021 is going to be my year, right? It is, we all know, everyone in this call knows that if nothing else, this is a blind faith optimism game that we are playing here. It's a persistence game. It requires you on a daily basis to say, I can do it. and so that's where the process is going to start, you know? So I always say to people, like when they're like, I think I might want to try writing. I'm like, well, you should start by saying I'm a writer. Like that's where this process begins. It's, you can call it manifesting, whatever you want to call it. But like, you have to begin 2021 by saying 2021 is my year. That's probably the best advice I can give you.
Mm-hmm. Rob.
It's interesting because I Trey teaches you know at USC. I teach at Syracuse, and one of the things you get you know, people are always saying like, geez, you're directing a movie and you're writing these, you know, whatever, 3-4 movies, and why, how in the world do you have time to do this? I'm like, no, I get stuff out of it. I get this like crazy magic kid energy out of it. I hear their ideas and I'm like, wow, I haven't thought like that in a million years. And it's just super fun. And so, yeah, keeping that part of it alive is huge. And a lot of times I'll see something, you know, they'll submit something to me and I'll just say like, no, absolutely not. And here's why. And then I'll realize, oh my God, I just did that. You know, I have an outline that I just sent out that did that exact thing, and I'm sure the people reading it are feeling the same annoyance with, you know, with the you know, tricks that I do. Yeah, so I look at it that way, and I also look at it like, it's interesting when I, with the years, when people ask a question like, oh, is 2021 going to be my year? The wrong way to ask that question is to say, what am I going to get out of 2021? The right way to ask it is, what am I going to give to 2021? Mm-hmm. You know, that look, we've all been through this thing. We are all, more than anything, the same idiot, you know, this entire time. Everybody has the same stories. Everybody has, you know, ridiculous, terrible batches of sourdough, and we've all been the same thing. There's no scenario where we would have all watched Tiger King, you know. And so here we are. We're united in this one thing, and this is a chance to tell just fantastic stories. If you have a great story to tell, you know, yeah, like Ava says, please do not remind me of what we've been through in 2020. You know, I don't want to hear anything about it. I don't want to hear politics. I don't want to hear anything. But yeah, if you have a great story to tell about, that comes from the heart, that you think can move people, you know, if you have something to say it in 2021. And and I want to hear it, you know, because I want to hear what everybody's up to. And that should answer its own question. You know, you give enough, then it comes back to you. I mean, that's the way this industry works.
Mm-hmm. Paul, New Year's resolution, and what do you want to say to those writers out there who are going to make 2021 their year, or give something to 2021 and make 2021 their year? I don't know. What Rob was saying.
New Year's resolution, I don't really do those, but I would say for me personally to just continue in this sort of state of gratitude and remember that kindness is not weakness. You know, it's like you can't ever be too kind, and it's incredibly powerful. As to those writers, like 2021 is the year, like Trey and Rob both keyed on things of you have to believe that and have that optimism, and you have to say what can I give as opposed to what can I get. For me, I would say trust for them, as far as trust yourself, trust your own voice, we all have inherent storytelling structure built in since we were toddlers. You know, don't feel like I have to do what Save the Cat says. I have to do what, you know, story says. I have to do, it's like trust your own voice and write your own story. And then also respect the craft. You know, I run into so many that, oh, I want to try being a screenwriter. I'd like to be a screenwriter. But they see it as like, oh, you stay in your pajamas all day and you write whenever you feel like it and you do. And it's like, no, you're going to fail. It's like you have to respect it as a vocation and a job, and you have to work your ass off, you know. And it's like, and especially in 2020, I had a thing going for a while. I'd put these little videos on my Instagram, and it was like, get out of your sweats and get off the couch, you know. Like, I know we're all going through this, but if you want to write, you know, it's like, get up, get dressed, and go to work. And to me, that's respecting the craft, you know. And I feel like now, especially, this is a little bit off topic, but I've been thinking so much during this whole conversation about that amazing Toni Morrison quote, you know, that in difficult times is precisely the time when artists go to work. You know, there's no time for despair, no time for self-pity. No, you know, we speak, we write, you know, this is how civilizations heal. Like her words just resonate right now with me so much. And that's what I'd say.
Great. Alex, a New Year's resolution, and what would you say to those writers out there about they're taking 2021 by the horns?
Well, you have to ask me next. Paul is a hard act to follow. Okay, so first of all, I don't do resolutions. I do goals. Personally, for me, so I started writing a spec I've been wanting to write for the last 10 years. It's been sort of this Moby Dick of an idea that has continually eluded me, and I finally decided to tackle it. So midway through it, and very much hoping to finish and see good things happen to it. There is also concurrently a TV show based on that book that I loved as a kid. It took me, I want to say about 15, 20 years to finally get the rights. It was one of those things which is like the rights was split up between different estates and there's no way in the world you can get it. Finally got it. And it's been in development with a studio. We attached a director, so it's going to go to market in early next year. Again, hoping to see good things happen. It's a real labor of love. And lastly, the chess story that I just mentioned. When I just finished watching Queen's Gambit, I'm like, oh my God, that story that I lived as a kid in Russia playing chess. I think there's a way to tell it. So speaking about writers, and this is speaking from experience as somebody who, it took me 10 years to become a writer. I was an exec and constantly talked about writing, constantly talked about telling stories, coming out of USC, but it took me 10 years to do that. Why? Fear. I feel like you can say I'm a writer. You can say I want to be a writer. It ain't worth shit. You got to write. And it's what Paul said. You got to treat it as a job, which means you don't wait for inspiration. You don't wait for the right idea. You don't wait to be in the mood. You sit down and you work. And look, I've been doing this now professionally for 15 years. I'm sure, Trey, you've been doing it longer because I remember reading and loving your scripts when I was an exec. It is fucking hard when you're doing it for a living. It's still hard. It's been really hard this year, but you got to do it. So to me, the way to make 2021 or 2022 or 2020 whatever your year is, commit to pouring yourself on the page and do so knowing that the only thing you control in life as a writer are the words on the page. And you got to break up pieces of your soul. You got to bleed on the page, because we were talking about earlier how the bar is really high. But I truly believe that when you find that undeniable idea and you infuse with that piece of yourself, which is undeniable emotion, your experience, and again, just kind of since we're summing it all up, how the more diverse points of view, the more eclectic voices, the shows that we love, they all tend to be sent all over the world because we can't travel anymore. So I want to see more content that is set in other countries. You find that, and I think it's going to sing. But it's on you. Nobody else will do it for you. Don't let the market dictate what story you're going to tell. Don't let the script defeat you, because I guarantee you there will become a point in your writing where, like, page 50, you just go, it's a shit, and you give up and you never finish. You got to do this. So you have the key, but it lies with patience and perseverance. And so that's what I say to all the writers out there, just punch the keys. To quote the late Sean Connery, punch the keys.
I love it. Alex Litvak, the motivational guru of Zoom. bringing us home, Ava. Bringing us home, New Year's resolution. And what would you say to those writers out there besides don't write a COVID script right now?
No, I think all those gentlemen have touched upon it. It's, you know, you got to put yourself in this, you know, and I think a lot of people look at us reps of like, all right, now I've got a rep and, you know, do everything for me. But it starts with you, you know, you're the engine as a writer of all of it. You know, we're here to be your, you know, a champion and an advocate and to hopefully provide opportunities or expand your opportunities beyond what you already have access to. But, you know, it's, and really kind of what Alex had said too, it's the stuff that makes something special is the stuff that has some of you in it. You know, and if it doesn't, it's not gonna resonate in a way that material really needs to just to stand out. So, you know, it's the, you know, we all grow and evolve, hopefully, as we get older and learn more about ourselves and or want to self-explore. And I think, you know, but those writers who do have reps, you know, vet a few of these ideas, you know, because at least for me, I want to make sure that that time that's being spent by that client is also time that's going to result in a reward, hopefully for them, in terms of whether it's a sale or expanding opportunities. So, you know, ideally for me, it's a client has, you know, here, I've got these two or three ideas that I'm really passionate about. And then this one, I think, is going to give you the best shot in the marketplace. And it's something you're passionate about. Great. So go put your time and your heart and soul into that. So for me, on my end, I just want to help guide that passion and that creativity so that it's also being ideally something that will make 2021 the best year yet, because it will come back for them in one way or the other in a meaningful way. And as far as resolutions, I don't really, I make them every so often, but they're really small usually, and something I can maintain, like make my bed every day for this year. And I've now done that 5 years in a row. So it's been great. Nice. That has now become a habit. To this last year, it was close every circle on my Apple Watch activity ring. So far I've done it. I think I will maintain that. It's been very hard to work out every day, but I've been doing it, you know? So it's just more like little personal wellness stuff like that, you know? I'm always trying to learn. I'm always trying to consume. I thankfully don't seem to have any trouble finding my inner 12-year-old. That's probably what's held me back in other ways in my life. But by the way, Trey, if you ever want to watch more Star Wars stuff or talk animated series or geek out on other cartoons, I have a number of things I could recommend to you. yeah, it's like I want to sort of try to keep maintaining that, just sort of that joy of what it means to work in this business, because it's a privilege.
Great. So thank you to our panel today, Alex, Ava, Trey, Paul, Rob, and everyone else who was here who had to depart early for other commitments. Thank you all for listening. Happy New Year to all of you. And let's all make 2021 the year, right?
Year.
So thank you, guys. I appreciate it.
And happy holidays, everybody.
Thank you. Happy holidays, everyone.
Thank you. You too, guys. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Now we blasting off into the ozone. The way we kick it in the dojo is local for show. Though we paving the road that's opposed to the dojo. Going over your head like a top hat. Stop that. I know you hear me spitting these hot raps. Now watch that beat, because it's about to drop. The rockets is the 09 jump off. Yeah, yeah.